Hello, everybody. Happy Friday. Thanks for joining us here on Schwab Coaching. My name is Lee Bowl, one of the education coaches here at Schwab. Today's topic is indicators and advanced charting techniques. I'm joined today by the ever popular James Boyd in the chat. So say hello to James. Let me ask you a question. Do you know how to find and trade stocks and ranges? Well, stay tuned and you're going to find out. But before we can get to all that good stuff, just a few logistical items. So we just have a few disclosures. So remember, everything we are doing today should be considered as educational and informational in nature only. Nothing is a trading recommendation. We'll be using a lot of technical analysis tools today, but Schwab does not recommend the use of technical analysis as your sole means of investment research. If we talk about paper money, remember, it's a great way to learn, but keep in mind also that results in paper money don't always translate to real-time conditions. Also, for the sake of simplicity, we will not include commissions or fees in today's discussion. And we all know, I think, that investing involves loss of principal. All right, so what we're going to talk about today is finding stocks and ranges, how to trade them, and we'll look at some examples. So let's start. We need to go over just a couple of basic things so we understand the indicators we're going to use today. So we're going to go over to thinkorswim. Whoops. All right. The first indicator we need to talk about, because we're going to be using this in our scans today, is the ADX. This is developed by Wells Wilder in his book, New Concepts in Technical Trading. In 1978, it was published. And it is a trend strength indicator. That's what we need to know. A scale between 0 and 100. The higher the number, the stronger the trend. And remember, it tells you the strength of the trend. It doesn't tell you the direction. But what I have on the chart here is the ADX looking back 14 periods. We're going to talk about that look back period today in a little bit more detail. But notice this stock is certainly uptrending, right? And the ADX is very high. It's 60, all right? So it just shows you it is a trend strength indicator, all right? The other indicator we need to know today is the stochastic. Many of you are familiar with that. But let me just put that on the chart too and explain it real quick, because we have to use these things together, all right, to both find and trade stocks in ranges. So the next indicator we're going to look at, again, review for some of you, I'm sure, will be stochastics. And for this example, we are going to use fast stochastics. All right, I'm going to put that on the chart. All right, and we are just going to review what stochastics does. So stochastics tries to tell you where the stock is in a recent trading range. If the stock is at the top of the trading range where it's been over the look back period, in this case, what is this? I think it's 10 periods. Yeah, 10 periods. We would have a number close to 100. Also, if it is near zero, that means you're down at the lowest part of the range over the look back period. All right. So we have both of those things to keep in mind. So those are the two indicators we're going to use today. I'm going to take them off the chart for right now, and then we'll put them back. Okay. So what we're going to do is step by step build a screen to find stocks and trading ranges in general. Then we're going to add to that screen to find stocks that are at the top of their range and the bottom of their range. So we can either perhaps buy near the bottom of range and sell near the top, or sell near the top of the range and cover near the bottom. That's what a lot of people do with ranges. So that's what we're going to try to do. So we're going to go over to the scan tab. All right, and we are going to start building step by step a way to find stocks in ranges, just in ranges. We're not going to talk yet about trying to put them at the bottom or the top of the range. We just want stocks that are in ranges first. All right, so the way we're going to do that is we are going to add a filter here. It is a study filter. So I should make a comment. if you are using paper money, you can't do study filters in paper money. So if you want to try these out in paper money, run the scan in your live side and then do the trade in your paper money account. Okay. All right. So let's pull this over, and we don't want ADX cross. So what we do is we click the little edit arrow there, or pencil, I guess it is. We don't want an ADX crossover. So we're going to delete that. But what we're going to do is add a study, and we're going to add the ADX. But I want now a rule of thumb that some technical traders use is how long should a range set up prior to trading it as a range. Some traders use a rule of thumb, okay, will tell us that 6 to 8 weeks. So just keep that in mind. So we're looking for a range that is set up at least over that time frame. So what we're going to do is we're not going to look back just the last 14 days, although we're going to do that as another step. We're going to look back 60 days, which is about a quarter. All right. So you want ADX for the last 60 days. We want a range bound stock. So we do not want this thing we don't want this thing trending higher if we're trying to trade a range, or trending lower. We want it range bound. So we have to do it. We'll say it's less than a value. All right. A rule of thumb that some traders use also is 20, something over 20. Okay. Yeah, could be trending. Something under 20 probably isn't. We're going to set this at 17. All right, so let's just see what we have first. All right. All right, so these are all stocks with a 60-day less than 17. Let's take a look at some of them. Yeah, so this had a big move. It's kind of in a range. That one doesn't look all that great for some traders. Let's look at another one. So let's look at AFL, perhaps. Yeah, there you go. So there's a stock in a nice tradable range, right? Okay, but we can do better than this, all right? What we can do is, in order to get both a longer term range and a shorter term that it hasn't moved out of that range, we're going to add another step in here. So we're going to go back to our scan. We're going to add another filter. We are going to add another study filter. We're going to do the ADX again. Okay. And this time we're going to have it shorter. We're going to use the default for the second step. So we're going to keep it at 14 periods. And we're going to say is less than 17. All right. So we could scan again, but it'll narrow it down a little bit. But now what we've got to do is do a little magic. All right. So what we're going to do next is we're going to do another study filter. We're going to do add a filter, study. We're going to take this out, but now comes the magic. All right. I'm going to pull up just a little script. I will give you the links for all these scans. I'm going to put them in the notes on the archive so we don't have to keep putting them in the chat. All right. So what we're going to do is get some code here that I wrote. And I want to show you what it is. So I'm going to put it in here. Okay. So when you're doing scripting, if you want to do a note, you just put a little number sign. Okay, that's the first thing. So this just says that I wrote it. Input length. So we're going to be using range. We set to 60 days the longer term ADX. So that's the range I want to get. I want a tradable range, but I don't want it to be 100% because that's not really a range, right? The stock could go from one, you know, up 30% and down 30%. You know, that's not really a tradable range. So what we're going to do here is do the following. So I'm seeing the length and then I'm defining the highest point, okay, over the last 60 days. But remember, when you do scripts, all right, you can basically go right in here and set the look back period. So I just, we set it to 60, but you can change that. All right. All right. So we're looking for the highest high over the last 60 days. We're looking for the lowest low over the last 60 days. Okay. And then we're looking the range. This is a percent, right? The highest minus the lowest over the highest times 100 is the percent. And I set that range to less than 15%. So that is a tradable range. All right. So we're going to throw this in here. And now let's do a scan and it'll probably eliminate some. All right. All right. So let's just take a look at a couple of these. We've got AFL we already looked at. You can see a lot of them dropped off now. All right. So let's go ahead and take a look at, I don't know, Air Products. Let's see if we got a range on that one. Well, yes, we do. Nice range, right? Whoops. Very nice trading range, right? So this will get you stocks in ranges, all right? Now, you could go through all. So let's say you wanted to buy at the bottom of the range, all right? You could look at all of those stocks that we just found that are in ranges. I'm scanning in the Russell 1000, by the way. But that's a lot of work. And what we try to do is have these scans do a little bit more work for us than just having to look at hundreds of charts, which is fun, granted. But so we need to modify this scan. Let's look for stocks first that are at the bottom of the range. Then we're going to modify stocks, the scan, to look for stocks at the top of the range. All right. And that should give us maybe some actionable ideas. So how are we going to do all that? Well, let us go back to our scan. All right. And what we're going to do now is add a couple of things here. So I'm going to take out this. I'm going to take out my little script there because I'm going to put in a new one. All right. But we're going to get rid of that. So the first thing I'm going to do also, remember we talked about stochastics, right? So one way to get the stock maybe at the bottom of the range is look for a low stochastic value, means the stock is sold off a little bit. But that's not going to be necessarily, okay, enough. But we're going to add that first. So we're going to do that by going here and actually I'm going to do in the Russell, well, we'll do in the Russell 1000 later. Let's add in that stochastic. So what we're going to do here is go and we're going to add a filter. Again, it's going to be a study filter. And what we do is we slide this over. We hit the pencil to edit it. We take out what's there. Okay. And now we're going to add the stochastics in here. And for this purpose, some traders might default to the faster stochastic as opposed to the slower stochastic. Okay. So what we do, if you want this oversold, well, we need the stochastic to be less than 25, less than 20, something like that. So we're going to do is less than a value here. This will get us oversold near the bottom of the range, but we're going to add one more little script in there to get us even closer to the bottom of the range, okay? So we'll say less than 25. And now we're gonna add another filter and I'm gonna explain the script on this one, okay? So we're gonna add a study filter and we are going to edit this one. We're gonna take out this one. Let me go over to my code thing here and we're going to go to ThinkScript editor and we're just going to pop it in here. All right. So again, this I wrote this range at the bottom of the range. How do we do that? So everything was the same we did before, but I've defined a new variable here, DFL. That means distance from the low. How did I get that? I just said I want the close, where the close is, minus the lowest we've been over the last 60 days, because that's our look back, and dividing that by the close times 100, that gives us the percentage where we are from the low. I set that. I just want less than 2% from the low, again, with the range of the stock in the 60-day look-back period being no more than a 15% range, all right? So hopefully you understand that. And we shall go here. And let's scan here. Let's change it to the Russell 1000, just for fun. So these are our big cap stocks, Russell 1000. All right. So what's the first thing you notice? So this is another way that scanning kind of gives you a feel for the market. I see a lot of energy stocks in here, right? Cheniere, EOG, Devon, ConocoPhillips. So maybe that's telling us that energy stocks are a little bit range bound. Let's take a look at a couple of them. We're going to take a look at two of the energy stocks, EOG and COP. All right. There you go. You got a stock bouncing off the bottom of the range, just like our scan said. Now, the question is, let us put up the stochastics and see if we can do any fine tuning here. But certainly we got what we wanted, right? A nice trading range at within 2% of the bottom of the range. That's exactly what we want. All right. But let's throw in the stochastic on the chart. Doing that to me. There we go. All right. So the signal with stochastics. So this is exactly what we scan for. Okay. But we have not crossed back above the oversold level. So this one probably is not ready for prime time at the moment. What we'd be looking for the actual trading signal at the bottom of the range, what some traders use is you want the percent K, which is the fast line, to cross above the percent D, which is the slow line. Really, all that is a three-period moving average of percent K. We have got a question from Holly. What is stochastic fast? So stochastics, again, what it does is just tells you where in the range that you are measuring. So that's the look-back period. We're using here a 10-day look-back, okay? So it's saying, where are we vis-a-vis the high and low over the last 10 days. If we were right at the absolute low, the stochastic value would be zero. If we were right at the 10-day high, the stochastic value would be 100. Okay, that's what you need to know. So right now, we are certainly oversold. We have percent K crossing percent D, but we haven't really gone back over the oversold boundary, which is something that we'd like. All right. So, you know, you could take this one perhaps, but some traders might wait for at least the percent K line, the fast line, to cross back above the oversold level. All right. Let's go look at ConocoPhillips. Somebody wanted to see that. All right. This looks similar. It looks like they both started to sell off again. So, you know, if this starts rising back towards the high of the day, we might get a signal. Here we have percent K and percent D right about the same. Okay. We have a little bit of a crossover, you know, because the orange line is a little bit above that, but we haven't gone back above 20. So some traders might wait on this one. Those are the two I wanted to show. Let's just take a look at another one. Those are the ones I had also. The other thing we could do here is let's go back to the list. Let's take a look at a non-energy stock. Let's take a look at Air Products. Same thing. All right. So these are all going to the bottom of the range. We do not have the signal yet. So these would be put on watch lists. Somebody is saying you could trigger an order. You could say if you wanted to do something like that, you could have an order, a conditional order, if percent K crosses percent D and it's over 20, you know, put in an order. You could do something like that too. But we have another question from Cola. Is this kind of scan only applicable to just buying stocks instead of options? Well, obviously, if you're trading options on a stock, the stock has to be doing something that you like. So we're not going to talk about options today, but perhaps some might do neutral strategies with stocks and ranges, perhaps, or we don't really have the disclosures to talk about options today, but you know, you find the stock and then you can, what's doing what you want, and then you could tailor an option strategy to that. All right. So that's how we got stocks at the bottom of the range. Let's move on and get stocks at the top of the range. Okay. How are we going to do that? So let's go back to our scan. All right. We're going to take off this stochastic. And we're going to take off my little script because this is the bottom script. All right. And now we're going to add in something to get it to the top of the range. So from what I just did, how do you think we do that? Well, we could add a stochastic and have it be overbought, couldn't we? So let's start there. All right. So we're going to go here to add a filter. Study, move it over, edit it, take out what's there if you don't want it, click add condition. It's a study condition. Again, we want stochastics fast. All right, this time we want it greater than maybe 70 or 75. You know, let's do 75. Some people might use 80 there. Okay. And now we're going to add another little script to make sure we're near the top as well. Okay. So we're going to add another filter, study. Take this out. I'm going to go over to my little code sheet here. And I'll stick this in. All right. So it's pretty much the same. We just changed a few of the parameters. All right. So again, we got our range from the way that we talked about. This time, I defined DFH, distance from high. Okay. And again, this is how I got that. The highest minus the close divided by the close times 100 will give you the percent where it is near the top. And I want that less than 2%. So we're going to get a stock that has an overbought stochastic within 2% of the top of the range, assuming the range is not greater than 15% over the last 60 days. All right. All right. Well, we got a different list, didn't we? So I'm just going to show you two in here. All right. let's take a look at Church and Dwight, and then we'll take a look at maybe Molina Healthcare, perhaps. Now let's take a look at Church and Dwight. Wait a minute. Actually, I meant Choice Hotels. I'm sorry. Choice Hotels. CHH. Uh-huh. Yeah, there we go. Now, this one could be setting up. Why? Well, we're at the top of the range. We bounced off. We took out the low of the day. It tested the top right now. We have percent K crossing percent D, and it is breaking the oversold level. So this potentially for some traders might be considered a bearish setup. All right, let's take a look at another one. When I say Molina Healthcare, now this is kind of odd because healthcare has been really rocking, but it's been more the pharmaceutical stocks. This is a managed care company. Let's take a look at that one. Aha, uh-huh. Now this one's a little different. Well, you got a very nice range, obviously. We hit the top of the range. We took out the low of the day of the test of the range, but now we're above it again. Also, let's zoom in here on the stochastics real quick. I'm going to zoom in one more time. I just want to get a better look at that. Well, we still have percent K, just a shade under percent D, and it is dropping down. Now, if some traders were trading this, it does meet the criteria. Maybe to fine-tune the entry, what some traders might do is wait until the current trade drops back below this low. So if the tail starts getting bigger and we take that out, then maybe for some people that could be an entry. Okay. Can you share the yellow range line script? I just put it in there having scanned these. So that's not an automatic thing. I just drew them in there just to make my point for you guys. There's probably a way to automate that, but I don't know right off the top of my head. Now we have another question. Can we scan in the S&P 500? Sure. This is from Mr. Market. Can you tell me which of those scans you wanted, the top, the bottom, or just a range? And we can do that. We have a question from Zinc 560. Didn't CHH break out of the range and now testing prior resistance? Let's go and take a look. Oops. Now, I'm just looking at a 3-month chart because remember where you're kind of using a 60-day look back. You could say maybe the range was in the top here, but given the way we had 1, 2, 3, 4 hits there, that's why I drew the line up there. Okay. All right. Mr. Market wants us to scan the S&P 500 for stocks near the top of a range. All right. We aim to please. Let's do that. So we'll change this to, this is a top of the range scan. We'll just change this to S&P 500. So I think some of these stocks are in the S&P 500 anyway, but yeah, so CHH fell out, Choice Hotels. Church and Dwight is in there, Fox News, Lockheed Martin. So these were all in the S&P 500. You know, we can look at Coke. Let's look at Coke. Yeah, right at the top of the range. This one is not triggering according to the criteria we talked about. We do have a very nice trading range. We're at the top of it, but All right, stochastics is not giving the signal yet. So this one, perhaps some traders might wait on. Okay. All right, so that's what I wanted to cover today. I'm gonna check the questions, make sure we got everything in here. Okay, we have a question. Have you added RSI, OBV, or any other indicator to measure a potential divergence in the previous test of the lower range? Would this work? Yes, that's not a bad idea. We could look for that. Let's. I didn't put it in the scan, but if you are trying to scan the charts and you are trying to decide one versus another, let's do a bottom scan. Let's put up the RSI for divergences and see if we can get a clearer picture to that question, which is a good question. All right. So let's go back and scan the Russell 1000 for stocks near the bottom of the range. Then we'll put the RSI on the chart and we'll see if we see any divergences anywhere. Should we do that? All right, so we'll do here Russell 1000. Oops. Come on, Lee. And the scan we want is range bottom, right? Oh, you know what? This isn't the whole scan. This is when I was building. Let me just add, let me stop it. Let me just take this off for a second. Check this. Okay, this is good. That's good. I don't know why it's not running. We just did it. Let's put in the stochastic. Maybe that's something too. Let's put in that. We'll just add another one here. Oh, I see it's stuck. All right. So let's see if we can do this. We already have the stochastic in there, right? We got the stochastic in there. Let me just see what's missing. All right, so this is the range, stochastic. And the lowest, we'll take this off. Maybe it's stuck on that list. Let's try it. All right, so something's wrong with this scan. It was working before you saw it, so I could reload it. Oh, this is why. That didn't get out of there. Okay, is that gone now? There we go. All right. So we were looking at EOG, were we not? And COP. Let's put up the RSI then. Okay. That was the question. All right. So let's now for divergences. Some traders feel the RSI works better than stochastic. So though any oscillator can give you a divergence signal, right? So let us look, put up the RSI. We'll take off the stochastics and put up the RSI to look for divergence down here. Now, 14 period look back. Some people might use 10 there. Okay, let's apply that. All right. So, oh, this is at the top, isn't it? We were looking at EO. We need EOG up there. We just did that scan and it was EOG. All right. So do we have a divergence? A tiny bit from this low. It is not glaring though on this one. Okay. So we're not getting a whole lot of help from that one. The reason I think some traders like stochastics is you got the two lines, which gives you a little bit of a heads up as opposed to the RSI, which is one line. Now you could put a moving average on the RSI and make it like stochastics. I can show you how to do that at some point. We don't have time today, but then let's look at ConocoPhillips. Yeah, kind of the same thing. There really isn't a divergence. I mean, it's a tiny bit higher than here, but it's not glaring. You know, what you like to see is it up here as opposed to the last low. So we could go through the list, but absolutely to your point, you could use that as a secondary indicator. You could also use unbalanced volume and see if you get a divergence there or a confirmation. So you can always add other indicators. If you put too many indicators in the scan though, then you often don't get any, okay? So I would just throw that out. So you wanna make the scan, you know, sharp, but not so restrictive that it just doesn't find anything, because you can always play around with them a little bit. All right. We have a question on this double. If you consider this a double bottom, you know, let's go to a year and see if it looks more like a double bottom. So it is a shorter term double bottom in an uptrend. The question was, there is a way also to evaluate double bottoms with Bollinger bands. Wasn't part of my agenda for today, but I'll show you what that signal is. Okay. So let's go and put on Bollinger bands then. And I'll tell you what we might be, let's take off these lines. And we're just going to look at, all right, so we're going to zoom in to this is the double bottom we're talking about, okay? So we're going to zoom in there. So what do we look for double bottoms with a Bollinger Band signal, okay? As a matter of fact, we're actually getting one on this. So here is what it is, all right? We've got these lows were clearly outside of the lower Bollinger Band. This is a matching low, but it is within the Bollinger Band. Some traders use that as a signal that this low was made with a little less momentum than this low. For some traders, that would be considered a positive attribute of that double bottom. Okay. All right. Let me just check the questions. I think we're about done. Yep. There is a survey in there. If you like this kind of scanning, just, you know, put a note in there. Also check the archive. I'm going to put the range scan, the top of the range and the bottom of the range scan in the notes in the description on the archive so you have them. All right. So thank you very much for your kind attention. We have a long weekend coming up. Of course, let's think about what it's about for Dr. King and check you all later. Take care. Thank you.